Namaste dear students, welcome to online tutorials on data communication subject. So today we will start module 3. In module 3 we have three important topics. The first one is bandwidth utilization, next one is switching, and the last one is error detection and correction. So we are going to study about bandwidth utilization today. So it is chapter 6 in your textbook, data communications and networking by Forizon, 5th edition. So the chapter name is bandwidth utilization. Here we have a key term which we have learned in last two modules, that is in first and second module, that is bandwidth. If you remember, bandwidth refers to the data throughput capacity of any communication channel. We can call it as capacity of the channel is bandwidth. So I have given you an analogy of pipe and water. The larger the pipe, the more water can flow through it at a faster rate. If the pipe is smaller, then less amount of water can flow through it in a little bit lower rate. So the same analogy is used here. And coming to the topic here, it is bandwidth utilization. Why we have to utilize the bandwidth wisely is the question here, and we are going to answer it in this chapter. So in this chapter we are going to discuss about two sections. The first one is multiplexing and the second one is spectrum spreading. In multiplexing we are going to discuss about three techniques, that is frequency division multiplexing, wavelength division multiplexing, and time division multiplexing. Soon we will come to know what these things are. In real life, we have links with limited bandwidths. The wise use of these bandwidths has been, and it will be one of the main challenges in electronic communication systems. However, the meaning of wise here may depend on the application. Sometimes we need to combine several low bandwidth channels to make use of one channel with a larger bandwidth. Sometimes we need to expand the bandwidth of a channel to achieve goals such as privacy and anti-jamming. So what is the key term here? Why we use multiplexing? Because of efficiency. And in the second part, or in the second section of this chapter, we are going to learn about spreading, which will help in privacy and anti-jamming. So we will explore these two broad categories, that is bandwidth utilization through multiplexing and spectrum spreading. So in multiplexing, our goal is efficiency. As we have already discussed, we combine several channels into one. You know the meaning of the word multiplexing. It means combining several into one. So here we will combine several channels into one channel. In spectrum spreading, our goals are privacy and anti-jamming. We expand the bandwidth of a channel to insert redundancy, which is necessary to achieve these goals here. So we will start multiplexing first. Whenever the bandwidth of a medium linking two devices is greater than the bandwidth needs of the devices. Suppose if the bandwidth of the medium here means channel. So the channel's bandwidth is greater than the device's bandwidth, the link can be shared, or that channel can be shared. Multiplexing is the set of techniques that allows simultaneous transmission of multiple signals across a single data link. So what is multiplexing? It is a set of techniques that allows simultaneous transmissions of many signals through a link, through a single link. That is what is main here. And as data and telecommunications use increases, so does its traffic also increases. We can accommodate this increase by continuing to add individual channels each time a new channel is needed, or we can install higher bandwidth link and use each to carry multiple signals. Each has a bandwidth. As data and telecommunication uses increases, so does the traffic. So we are discussing about three sections in this multiplexing, that is frequency division multiplexing, wavelength division multiplexing, and time division multiplexing. So what are these? We will discuss shortly. In a multiplexed system, here in this figure, you can see there is a multiplexed system. In a multiplex system, n lines share the bandwidth of one link. You can see it clearly here. What we are doing in this figure, n input lines are sharing the bandwidth of one link, this link. One link, n channels. So figure 6.1 shows the basic format of a multiplexed system. The lines on the left direct their transmission streams to a mux. Here is the mux, which combines them into a single stream. This is a single stream. This is a many-to-one transmission. At the receiving end, that stream is fed into a demultiplexer. You can see a demux here. At the receiving end, we will keep a demux, which separates the stream back into its component transmission. So this is the basic idea of multiplexing. So at the sender end, we use a mux. We combine several links into a single stream, and at the receiver end, we use a demux, which separates the stream back into its component transmissions and directs them to the corresponding lines. We will solve many examples. You will come to know what or how mux and demux works in real time. In the figure, the word link refers to physical path here. We have mentioned a word link here. It refers to the physical path. The word channel refers to the portion of the link that carries a transmission between a given pair of lines. One link can have n channels. Please note this. One link can have n channels. I have differentiated two words here, link and channel. Right? Link refers to the physical path and channel refers to the portion of a link. This is the main difference you have to get to know before solving problems in this section. Right? So, n channels make one link. Please note this point. Then, going to the next slide, categories of multiplexing. We have three basic multiplexing techniques. First one is frequency division multiplexing. Second one is wavelength division multiplexing. And the third one is time division multiplexing. So let us get into these things first. Then we will start what is FDM. So what are these three things? Frequency division multiplexing, wavelength division multiplexing, and time division multiplexing. So FDM, the technique is to combine several analog signals into a single analog signal. The second method, that is WDM or wavelength division multiplexing, it means that we are combining several optical signals into one optical signal. The third method is called as time division multiplexing. It allows several digital signals to share a channel in a given time. So this is a brief introduction on these three categories, multiplexing categories. These are the three multiplexing categories. And there is another technique called as carrier division multiple access as a fourth multiplexing category. We will discuss CDMA in next module. So now we will discuss FDM in detail in this video. What is FDM or frequency division multiplexing? So frequency division multiplexing, it is an analog technique that can be applied when bandwidth of the link is greater than the combined bandwidth of signals to be transmitted. So you can refer from this figure. So what I told is, FDM is an analog technique that can be applied when the bandwidth of the link is greater than the combined bandwidths of signals to be transmitted. In FDM, signals generated by each sending device modulate different carrier frequencies. So these modulated signals are then combined into a composite signal that can be transported by a link. So what we have, the same setup we have as we have seen in figure 6.1. Many input lines are there and a mux is kept. What I have explained? I have explained that signals generated by each sending device modulate different carrier frequencies. These modulated signals are then combined into a single composite signal that can be transported by the link here as shown in the figure, as marked by me. Then carrier frequencies are separated by sufficient bandwidth to accommodate the modulated signal. These bandwidth ranges are the channels. See here, this link is divided into many channels, channel 1, channel 2 and channel 3. Between each channel, you have something called as guard band. So it is called as guard band. So whenever a channel is made between two channels, there will be a guard band kept in between them. So these bandwidth ranges are channels through which the various signals travel. Channels can be separated by strips of unused bandwidths. These unused bandwidths we call it as guard bands to prevent signal from overlapping each other. Why these guard bands are kept? They help us to prevent signals from overlapping. That is the use of guard bands. In addition, carrier frequencies must not interfere with original data frequencies. That care we should take before sending signals. So figure 6.3, it gives you a conceptual view of FDM. In this illustration, the transmission path is divided into three parts, each representing a channel that carries one transmission in this figure. So what we have seen in this figure, totally there is at sender side we have three sending points, and these three signals are muxed or they are combined into a link, and this link has three different channels. So what we are doing here, in channel 1 we are sending a signal with one different frequency, in channel 2 we are sending a signal with another frequency, and in channel 3 we are sending it with another frequency. So these frequencies will not match and they will not mix, and between these channels we have something called as guard band. This is what we have studied in this figure. Let us move to the next slide. We have a note here. We consider FDM to be an analog multiplexing technique. So however, this does not mean that FDM cannot be used to combine sources sending digital signals. So a point to be noted here is FDM is an analog multiplexing technique that combines analog signals, right? So we will see how multiplexing process works in FDM. So to understand this, we will see its figure. This is FDM process. Figure 6.4, it gives you a conceptual illustration of multiplexing process. So each source here, you can see the sources, each source here generates a signal of a similar frequency range. Inside the multiplexer, this is the multiplexer. Inside the multiplexer, these similar signals modulate different carrier frequencies. You can see carrier frequency F1, F2 and F3 here. So the resulting modulated signals are then combined into a single composite signal. We can see it here. All these signals, this plus this results in this, similarly the other two, and whereas the collection of these, all these things makes or gives out this composite single signal. The result, it is called as resulting modulated signal. It is sent over a media link that has enough bandwidth to accommodate it. This is multiplexing process in FDM. And coming to demultiplexing process, we will see it with again diagram there. Figure 6.5 illustrates the concept of demultiplexing process in FDM. So the demultiplexer uses a series of filters to separate the signals into three different categories or into three different sources at the receiver end. We use filters there. So the demultiplexer uses a series of filters to decompose the multiplex signal into its constituent component signals. The individual signals are then passed to a demodulator. This is demodulator. The composite signal is passed through filters and we will get individual signals there. And these individual signals are passed through a demodulator wherein carrier signals are separated and the output lines are sent to the three different sources again. So this figure, 6.5 figure, it gives a conceptual illustration of demultiplexing process. I hope you understood. So let us solve a problem here. I'll read out the problem. Later we will solve it. Assume that a voice channel occupies a bandwidth of 4 kilohertz. Understand the question. Assume that a voice channel occupies a bandwidth of 4 kilohertz. So the bandwidth of the channel is 4 kilohertz here. Channel. We are talking about channel, not link. We need to combine 3 voice channels into a link. So we have 3 such voice channels which is combined to make a link with a bandwidth of 12 kilohertz. So 4 plus 4 plus 4 is 12 kilohertz, and the bandwidth range here is 20 to 32 kilohertz. So the difference between these two is 32 minus 20 is 12 kilohertz. That is what we needed. And we need to show the configuration using the frequency domain. Assume there are no guard bands. Here the assumption in the question is there are no guard bands. If there are guard bands, that extra frequency we need to add, and that will not fall in this 20 to 32 kilohertz range. So they have made us to assume there are no guard bands. So let us solve this. Let us see about the solution. So I'll illustrate it with a diagram, the help of a diagram, figure 6.6. So the first subscriber line, it has 4 kilohertz bandwidth. It is marked with blue here. And the second subscriber line, it is again 4 kilohertz line. The third one is also a 4 kilohertz line. What is FDM? So here at the sender side, we have a modulator. And at the receiver side, we have a demodulator. We will discuss it later. So what is the range? Range of the channel, sorry, link is from 20 to 32. From 20 to 32, that is mentioned here. So first 4 kilohertz, that is from 20 to 24, it is for the first channel, sorry, the first user. And the second one, that is 24 to 28, it is for the second one. And 28 to 32, that is for the third one. So that will be, these 3 lines will be combined into a single one. That is, 3 channels are combined into a single link. That link has bandwidth from starting from 20 to 32. The higher bandwidth link, that composite signal is sent to through a higher bandwidth link. And at the receiver side, we as we have seen in the previous figure, we have band pass filters here. Why band pass filters are used? I have taught you 3 types of filters. The first one is band pass, low pass and high pass. Low pass filters, what they do is, we know that, no need to discuss in this video. Low pass filters allow signals, they allow frequencies starting from 0. High pass means they allow frequencies not starting from 0, and band pass means certain frequencies are only allowed. So here in this first part, it allows only frequencies from 20 to 24. This is how the signal is separated. And the second band pass filter, it differentiates signals between 24 to 28 kilohertz. Then the third one separates, or it has band between 28 to 32. So like this, we separate signals from a composite signal at the receiver end, and those signals are sent to respective users. So this is how FDM works. Okay, then we will see the next question. Example 6.2, I'll read it out. 5 channels, each with a 100 kilohertz bandwidth, are to be multiplexed together. What is the minimum bandwidth of the link? If there is a need for a guard band of 10 kilohertz between the channels to prevent interference. So we will understand the question. There are 5 channels, each with 100 kilohertz bandwidth. So what is the bandwidth of each channel? 100 kilohertz. So we need 500 kilohertz bandwidth to occupy these 5 channels in a single link. Then plus we need to add guard bands between every channel. So what is the minimum bandwidth of the link, they have asked. So what is the answer for this? It is 540 kilohertz. How? I'll illustrate it using this diagram. So there are 5 channels represented using 5 different colors here. So each channel has a bandwidth of, or each channel is of 100 kilohertz. So 100 plus 100 plus 100 plus 100 plus 100, it is 500. And we need to give a guard band of 10 kilohertz between each channels. So 10 here, 10 here, 10 here, and 10 here. So 500 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10, then it is 540. So the answer for this question is 540. Then the next one. Before going to solve this problem, we will see something called as regarding this previous example. I want to tell you something that is very important and that is followed by every telecommunication network. So it is called as the analog carrier system. To maximize the efficiency of their infrastructure, all the telephone companies, what they have done is they have traditionally multiplex signal from lower bandwidth lines onto a higher bandwidth line. In this way, many switched or leased lines can be combined into fewer but bigger channels. For analog lines, this FDM technique is used. So one of these hierarchical systems used by telephone companies is made up of groups, supergroups, master groups, and jumbo groups. So what is this groups, supergroups, master groups, and jumbo groups? So in this analogy, 12 voice channels we have represented in the previous figure, this figure. Such 12 voice channels are multiplexed onto a higher bandwidth line to create a group. So what is group? It is just mixture of, or it is multiplexing of 12 voice channels. So a group has 48 kilohertz of bandwidth, 12 into 4, 48 kilohertz of bandwidth, and it supports 12 voice channels. So at the next level up, we have five groups are multiplexed to create a composite signal called a supergroup. A supergroup has a bandwidth of 240 kilohertz. So 48 into 5, that is 240 kilohertz, and it supports up to 60 voice channels. So each supergroup has 5 groups. So 5 into 12 is 60 voice channels it will support. Then at the next level, 10 supergroups are multiplexed to create a master group. So in a master group, we have the bandwidth of that master group is 2.4 megahertz, and we have some 600 voice channels because 10 supergroups are combined here. Supergroups means 60 voice channels will be there. So 10 supergroups means 600 voice channels will be there. Finally, 6 master groups can be combined into a jumbo group. A jumbo group must have 15.12 megahertz. That is 6 into 2.52. 15.12 megahertz of bandwidth it should have. And can you calculate number of voice channels? It is 6 times the supergroup. 6 into 600, that is 3600 voice channels will be there in jumbo group. So the hierarchy, as I have told, is the first one is group, 12 voice channels. Next level is supergroup, it has 60 voice channels. Next level is master group, it has 600 voice channels. Then the next one is jumbo group, which has 3600 voice channels. Okay, then we have some useful applications of FDM, that is frequency division multiplexing. One of that useful application is AMPS, that is the advanced mobile phone system. We will solve one of the example on that. The advanced mobile phone system uses two bands. The first band of 824 to 849 megahertz is used for sending, and 869 to 894 megahertz is used for receiving. So please note here, sending and receiving signals are different here. It is similar to uplink and downlink, or uploading and downloading links. So the first band, which is dedicated for only for sending, that is between 824 to 849 megahertz, and the second one that is mentioned in the question, that is for receiving, 869 to 894. Each user has a bandwidth of 30 kilohertz. Users have bandwidth of 30 kilohertz here, kilohertz, not megahertz, in each direction. How many people can use their cellular phones simultaneously is the question. So let us solve this. So each band is 25 megahertz. How it is 25 megahertz? So it is 849 minus 824 is 25, whereas 894 minus 869. The difference of these two numbers is 25. So each band is 25 megahertz. What is the difference indicates? It indicates the band size. Band sizes of 25 megahertz. If we divide 25 megahertz by 30 kilohertz, why we have to divide it by 30 kilohertz? Because in question, they have given as each user has bandwidth of 30 kilohertz in each direction, they have given. Right, so if you divide 25 megahertz by 30 kilohertz, you will get the answer as 833.33. So in reality, the band is divided into 832 channels. In reality, it is divided into 832 channels. Of these, 42 channels are used for control. They are called as controlling channels. Certain channels need to be put for under this heading, that is control channels, which means 832 minus 40 is around 790 channels are available for cellular phones, right? So this is the answer for that. So we have 790 channels that can be used for assigning for many users, or they are assigned for several cellular phone users. Okay, so this is all about frequency division multiplexing. In the next video, we will see about wavelength division multiplexing. So till then, take care. Goodbye.